Welcome to worship on this first Sunday in February. Celebration is a church of welcome and inclusion, and we are glad that you have chosen to spend this hour with us. If you want to know more about our church, go to our website and call or email us. If you're interested in becoming a member of Celebration, you can also call or email the church. Today is Super Bowl Sunday. And we pray that you will find safe ways to celebrate. Celebration is a diverse group of believers who have joined together on this journey of faith. I'm Joreen Taylor Swift. I'm the pastor of Celebration. During the pastoral prayer, there will be a moment of silence toward the end of the prayer. And don't forget your bread and your wine for communion later in the service. At Celebration, we believe that it is around the table where we sense God's welcome to all of God's children. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Lift up your hearts.
Our call to worship. Gather us in, the brokenhearted and the joyful, the weak and the strong. Gather us in, the fearful and the brave, the young and the old. Gather us in to sing of God's works, to praise Jesus Christ. Gather us in to worship and wonder and know of God's love.
Let us pray. God of life, God of hope, God of all, lift us on your love like eagle's wings. Sustain us, guide us, heal us. Then send us forth into the world that we may love as you love. Amen.
Join us in singing hymn number 501, There Is a Balm in Gilead.
There is
reading from Isaiah. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint.
Please pray with me. Gracious and ever-loving God, our Maker, Redeemer, and Friend, we rejoice in all that you have done and all you continue to do to reveal yourself to us. God, you stand in majesty of a starlit night. You stand in the power of a storm, and you stand in the quiet moment before dawn. You live and move within our hearts, O God. You have breathed life into us that we might know you and join you in your work of redeeming the world. God, we search for assurances of your love for us. We long for relief from those things that keep us from hearing your call to join you in your business of loving that which you have created. We pray this day for all those who govern around the world. May they use their power and influence in the service of all. We pray for the leaders of our country. May they have the strength and the courage needed for each day. We pray for our city, our county, and their work in bringing healing and wholeness in this time of pandemic. We pray, O God, for your church around the world and for this congregation, that we might faithfully guide others to know your transforming love. We pray for those who are hurting this day, for those who feel empty inside, those whose hearts are breaking from grief or regret, for those who wrestle with demons of addiction or disease. We pray, O God, for those weary with struggling and those in danger of losing hope. We pray especially for Bill Jemison, Del Boyette and her family, Darlene Pettigo, Julie Pope, Daryl Whitten, David Adcock, Doris Casey, Nancy Crosskill, Glenda Gardner, Glenda Kramer, Chief Master Sergeant Hollis Selman, Shannon Mills Selman, Jelani Stafford, Pat Stafford, Joanne Peters, Joni Bolton, Julia Thieves, Julie Minshew, Kathy Myatt, Liz Rodriguez, Marty Faulkner, Tom Hopper, Virgie Allen, Anne Marie Hull and her family in the loss of her mother Barbara, Shoshana Clark Cook and her family in the loss of her father Franklin. God, we pray to always persist in our search to know you, to be at home in your love, and to rest in the promise of your grace. We lift up to you in silence the things which are pressing on our hearts. We pray with confidence, O God, that you hear our prayers this day. In the blessed name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
In the quiet hour I reach.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening, at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of grace.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. You have made us for yourself, O God, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. We come searching for something to believe in and live for. We come searching for a sense that our lives matter. We search for a community to stand with. And as we search, O God, find us, startle us with your love and grace, your mercy, and your truth. Amen. Fred Craddock used to tell a story about a town in southwest Oklahoma where he ministered for about 3 years. The population of the town was about 450 on a good day. There were plenty of churches, but the most consistent attendance was at the little cafe in town. The patron saint of the group at the cafe was a man named Bill. Fred says Bill was a good, strong man, a pioneer, a rancher, farmer, and a prospering cattleman. All the men who met there would tell you that old Bill never go to church. One day, Fred met Bill on the street in town. Now, Bill knew that Fred was a preacher, but Fred was never a preacher who confronted people and let them have it in the name of Jesus. But Bill spoke up immediately and said, "I work hard, I take care of my family, and I mind my own business. Far as I'm concerned, everything else is fluff." Well, Fred got the message that Bill was probably not a prospect for his church, so Fred never bothered Bill. But one Sunday morning, Bill showed up at the church and presented himself for baptism, and Fred baptized him. Bill was 77 years old, and Fred, the church, and certainly the men at the cafe were shocked. People in the town thought Bill must be sick. They thought he must be afraid of dying. You know how little towns are. There was all kinds of talk. The next day after his baptism, Fred was talking to Bill, and Fred said, "Bill, you remember that little saying you used to give me? I work hard, I take care of my family, I mind my own business." Bill said, "Yeah, I said that a lot." And Fred asked, "Well, do you still say that?" Bill said, "Yeah." "Then what's different?" Fred asked. Bill said, "Back then, I didn't know what my business was." Bill had discovered that his business was to serve human need, and it led him to the church. In our text for today, Mark immediately lets us know that Jesus is clear about what his business is. Last week, we talked about the man with the demons who was in the synagogue. Jesus healed him by exorcising the demons out of him. In today's reading, Jesus leaves the synagogue, goes to Simon Peter's home with his disciples. Peter's mother-in-law is sick with a fever. Jesus knows what his business is, and he doesn't shy away from people in need of healing. Jesus goes to her, takes her hand, lifts her up, and the fever leaves her. Mark then says, "And she began to serve them." Listen to how one person imagines what Peter's mother-in-law would say about what happened to her. "Do you know that Jesus healed me? I was sick. Jesus had never been here before, but he came to my pallet, he took me by the hand, and lifted me up. Simple enough. I was healed." Now, the difference between me and my boneheaded son-in-law is that I understood Jesus instantly. I immediately began to serve him. Peter, however, and he would tell you this himself, never quite got it until Jesus was resurrected. He took off with his brother and the two other fishermen, James and John. They followed Jesus. But no matter how much time Peter spent with Jesus, he was always expecting Jesus to do wonderful things for him. And many times I said to him, "You serve him, Peter." He always answered, "I am, Mother, I am." But I could never get through to him the difference between what he was saying and what we could all tell he expected of Jesus. So this woman, Peter's mother-in-law, was healed, and then she cooked them dinner. Now, we could pass right over this, or we could think about how chauvinistic of them to let her cook for them, cook dinner after being so ill. But many see her as a role model for discipleship. She understood the business that Jesus was to be about. Jesus came to heal and to preach, and she joins him in his call to serve others. Now, Jesus wastes no time in being about his business. One scholar writes that throughout his ministry, Jesus treated the people and their needs as holy by healing their bodies, their souls, and their psyche. Over and over again, the answer to why he healed was his compassion. Out of God's tender mercies, he healed them. Now, when I was preparing for this sermon, I noticed something about this passage of Scripture I had never realized before. You remember back in the first part of the first chapter of Mark, there is the story of Jesus calling some of the disciples. We are always in amazement that they left what they were doing, they followed Jesus immediately. And now, here Peter is later in the chapter going back home. Curious, isn't it? Scholars believe that Simon Peter's home was probably close to the synagogue in Capernaum. So it could be that Simon just told the others, well, we can go by my house and get something to eat. Or maybe he thought, well, if Jesus is healing all these people, he can heal my mother-in-law who's at home with a fever, which in that day could be a life or death problem. Or maybe the issue is that Peter hasn't yet realized the kind of business to which Jesus has called him. He hasn't realized that Jesus' business will call him away from home to other cities, to other people. These disciples were new to this work, and Jesus had his work cut out for him as he tried to help them. He wanted to help them understand his business. Now, we all know that there are many kinds of healing. Most of us are broken in some way and in need of healing. Sometimes it's a crisis of faith, or maybe we've suffered a huge loss. Perhaps we've failed to be honest with others and with ourselves about who we are. I saw a piece this week on the Today Show about a young man, Grant, who moved away from his family to pursue a new business and to begin a new romantic relationship. Both of those failed, but he was too embarrassed to tell his family. He felt like such a failure, and he began thinking about taking his own life. Now, Grant has an older sister, and she and her spouse had a young little boy about 18 months old. When they made their Christmas picture last year, they noticed that their son's eyes looked yellow, and his skin was a bit yellow as well. So they took him to the doctor, only to find that because of a rare disease, he was in liver failure. The only thing that would save him was a liver transplant. Now, most of you know that livers will regenerate, and so it is possible to take a part of an adult liver and give it to a child. The doctors began looking for a match. Neither parent worked. When Grant heard about his nephew's illness, he said that he had this overwhelming feeling that he should go with his sister and brother-in-law when they took his nephew to the specialist. When he heard what his little nephew was facing, he offered to be tested as a donor. He was a perfect match. Grant gave a part of his liver for his little nephew. His sister and brother-in-law know that he saved their son's life. But Grant says, no, he saved my life. If not for feeling I should go with him to the doctor, I would probably be dead today. In helping someone else, Grant found healing from his emotional wounds. So we gather in this room, each with our own pain. Others may know of it, or it could be private pain. Feelings of brokenness can disable, deplete, and disconnect us. It can tear holes in our heart. But the good news is this woundedness does not define us. Thomas Merton put it this way: there is in all visible things a hidden wholeness. This is the real truth about us. We have come from a place of oneness and wholeness with God. It is how God created us to be. Now Mark goes on and tells us that later that evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus all who were sick or possessed with demons. The text says, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out demons. You see, Jesus knows what his business is. His call from God is to heal and preach. But Jesus also knew that he could not do the work of God without times of restoration and healing for himself. So the next morning, while it is still dark, he goes out to a deserted place to pray. The text says that the disciples hunt him down, and when they find Jesus, they say, "Everyone's looking for you." Once again, the disciples don't understand. They put pressure on Jesus to be about the business that they think he is called to. "Come back, heal some more." But Jesus does not let them guilt him into straying from God's business. He knew he needed time alone in prayer to focus and to remember that to which God had called him. When we offer ourselves to God in prayer, we often find that our minds become more in tune with the mind of God. We can be changed as we pray. Marjorie Thompson writes, "Prayer has been compared to a furnace of transformation. If we're willing to see clearly what is in our hearts and offer it to God, we gradually discover what it means to be conformed to the image of God. We become whole and can become the complete creations that God intended. Because of Jesus' gift of love and grace to us, we too can learn to offer healing to others. God can help us use our own woundedness as a source of strength to help others find healing. We can make our deepest connection with God and others through the shared experience of suffering. Salvation is a lifetime of practice, receiving God's healing grace and power, being changed by it, and offering healing back to the world. The healed heal." So we can be healed even when we are not cured. At funerals, we often say that the one who has died has received God's final and perfect healing. There's no cure in this situation, but there is definitely healing. The healing God offers is much more than simply physical healing. If we can commit to healing our hearts, we can be changed from the inside out. We can face the future with hope in God who loves us even when we are far from perfect. God who invites us to share in offering healing to others. God who's always ahead of us, drawing us towards the light. If we can do the hard work of beginning to heal our hearts by looking within and looking to God, our church will become a fellowship of pilgrims on a journey to wholeness. We can continue to grow in our ability to be the kind of church that extends grace, that welcomes strangers, that listens, shares, laughs, and cries. A church that makes mistakes, that shows mercy, that gives thanks, that celebrates life, believes in love, and becomes family to each other. Jesus knew what his business was. And when the disciples find him praying, he says, "Let's go to the neighbor town so that I may proclaim the message there also." The disciples haven't yet realized that Jesus has called them to a business that's much broader than what they imagined. They would probably have preferred that Jesus stay in Capernaum, healing from his home base and theirs. But no, Jesus leads them out into their own dark wilderness, the unknown territory of introducing others to the kingdom of God. Jesus calls us too. And our job, just like the disciples, is to give ourselves to the family business. May it be so. Amen. Now is the time in the service when we would be bringing our offerings to the altar. It is always a reminder to us of our commitment to this church, to God's work in this congregation. We thank you for your faithfulness and your continued giving, for your commitment cards. They are still coming in. You can still send them to the church office. We thank you for the many ways that we are able to minister in the name of Jesus because of you and your gifts. And now we come to gather around this table, the table of Jesus, where Jesus is the gracious host. As I remind you many times, it does not belong to the church. It does not belong to me, for it is God's table. And so we invite you to get your bread and your wine as we share together in communion. Please pray with me. God, we thank you for these gifts of bread, the gift of this cup that nourish us. We thank you, O God. Amen. So on that night that Jesus sat with the disciples, He took the bread, he blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. When you eat it, remember, it is the body of Christ, the bread of life." And then he did the same with the cup. He said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin. Every time you drink this cup and eat this bread, remember me. Remember my love for you. It is the cup of grace, the blood of Christ." Please pray with me. God, when we come to this table where we are welcome, wounds and all, we are overwhelmed with your love and your grace. We are filled with gratitude, and we say thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen. And now, as we depart, as you go, remember, it is God's grace which is within us. It is God's love which surrounds us. So go now to preach words of freedom, justice, and peace. Amen.